Jesus before God. And the Jews with Jesus from Caiaphas to the palace of the Roman governor. By now it was early morning, and to avoid ceremonial uncleanness, the Jews did not enter the palace. They wanted to be able to eat Passover. So Pilate came out to them and asked, "What charges are you bringing against this man?" "If he were not a criminal," they replied, "we would not have handed him over to you." Pilate said, "Take him yourselves and judge him by your own law." "But we have no right to execute anyone," the Jews objected. This happened so that the words Jesus had spoken, indicating the kind of death he was going to die, would be fulfilled. Pilate then went back inside the palace, summoned Jesus, and asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" "Is that your own idea?" Jesus asked, "or did others talk to you about me?" "Am I a Jew?" Pilate replied. "It was your people and your chief priests who handed you over to me. What is it you have done?" Jesus said, "My kingdom is not of this world. If it were, my servants would fight to prevent any arrest by the Jews. But now my kingdom is from another place." "You are a king then," said Pilate. Jesus answered, "You are right in saying I am a king. In fact, for this reason I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone on the side of truth listens to me." "What is truth?" Pilate asked. With this he went out again to the Jews and said, "I find no basis for a charge against him, but it is your custom for me to release to you one prisoner at the time of the Passover. Do you want me to release the king of the Jews?" They shouted back, "No, not him. Give us Barabbas." Now Barabbas had taken part in a rebellion. John 19. Jesus sentenced to be crucified. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him flogged. The soldiers twisted together a crown of thorns and put it on his head. They clothed him in a purple robe and went up to him again and again, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews." And they struck him in the face. Once more, Pilate came out and said to the Jews, "Look, I am bringing him out to you to let you know that I find no basis for a charge against him." When Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe, Pilate said to them, "Here is the man." As soon as the chief priests and officials saw him, they shouted, "Crucify, crucify." But Pilate answered, "You take him and crucify him. As for me, I find no basis for a charge against him." The Jews insisted, "We have a law, and according to that law, he must die, because he claimed to be the Son of God." When Pilate heard this, he was even more afraid, and he went back inside the palace. "Where do you come from?" he asked Jesus. But Jesus gave him no answer. "You refuse to speak to me," Pilate said. "Don't you realize I have power either to free you or to crucify you?" Jesus answered, "You would have no power over me if it were not given to you from above. Therefore, the one who handed me over to you is guilty of a greater sin." From then on, Pilate tried to set Jesus free, but the Jews kept shouting, "If you let this man go, you are no friend of Caesar. Anyone who claims to be a king opposes Caesar." When Pilate heard this, he brought Jesus out and sat down on the judge's seat at a place known as the Stone Pavement, which in Aramaic is Gabbatha. It was the day of preparation of Passover week, about the sixth hour. "Here is your king," Pilate said to the Jews. But they shouted, take him away, crucify him." "Shall I crucify your king?" Pilate asked. "We have no king but Caesar," the chief priest answered. Finally, Pilate handed him over to them to be crucified.
Yeah, so we are continuing our quest to know who Christ is through the scriptures. The Apostle John wrote the book of John, a testimony. He was the firsthand witness of Jesus and his ministry, and he recorded this so that we may know who Jesus is, and by knowing who he is, we may believe in him. And so we've been walking through the book of John and the ministry and the life of Jesus, and today we're at the cross. It's a major point in the ministry and in the history of the world, actually. And since our last encounter with Jesus last week in John chapter 15, Jesus has been betrayed by Judas, and the infamous kiss of Judas. His disciples have all scattered. Jesus has been arrested. Peter has denied knowing Jesus three times. If you remember the rooster crowing, the Jewish Sanhedrin, which is the high court of Israel, has tried and already found Jesus guilty of blasphemy. And now in John chapter 18, Verse 28, Jesus is taken before Pilate, who is a Roman governor of the province of Judea, and events have been set in motion that will crucify God. That's a big way to start the sermon, right? Start our Sunday. The crucifixion of God. This week's sermon is titled The Cross, Fact, Doubt, Truth, and Belief. And the cross, it is central to our gospel message. The cross is preached throughout the church. A Bible without the cross would be unfinished. The church without the cross would be dead. Salvation without the cross is impossible, and the cross is central to everything that we believe. All of our hope and our faith are seen through the lens of the cross. And our message today happens to be, in John 18 through 19, the message of the cross. And we're going to see that in order for faith, we're going to cover these four things, but in order for faith to thrive, it must be based on fact. In order for doubt to be satisfied, it has to be answered by truth. And in order for belief to settle in one's heart, it must be chosen. So for the next few minutes, we're going to relive the last days of Jesus before the crucifixion. And we're going to see the cross defined through these four things, through fact, through doubt, through truth, and through belief. So first, can you go to the next slide, please? This is a lot up here. I'm just going to read it. Just put it up here for you guys. But many scholars, we're talking about the fact of the cross. And many scholars, they argue that the death of Jesus was the most documented event ever in the history of mankind. If you ever do any background and look into the history behind Christianity and the life of Jesus, it's the most documented event perhaps in the history of mankind. David Limbaugh, who is a six-time New York Times bestseller author, he wrote in his book, Jesus on Trial, and this is what I put up on the board, and he said this about the death of Jesus and the crucifixion of Jesus. The evidence for Christ's death is greater than that for almost any other event in the ancient world. The nature of his wounds, from whipping, crucifixion, and the spear thrust into his side, ensured his death. His mother, friends, and closest disciples witnessed his passing. The Romans, who were expert executioners, pronounced him dead, and Pilate double-checked to ensure it. The Jews never disputed that Jesus' dead body was buried in the tomb of the Sanhedrin member Joseph of Arimathea. Non-Christian writers from the first and second centuries, including Josephus, Tacitus, Thallus, Lysian, and Phalgon, the Jewish Talmud recorded Jesus' death. And modern medical authorities, having examined the evidence, have verified his demise. And early church fathers such as Polycarp, who was the first-hand disciple of John, who wrote this book, and Ignatius confirmed the death of Jesus on the cross. So he summarized this. By the way, I bought this book and read the book. It's a really good book. In addition to this, Jesus himself declared that he was dying on the cross when he committed his spirit to the Father's hands. In Luke 23, the Apostle John, who we're studying right now, was an eyewitness to the events of Jesus, and we're going to dive in that today in John 18 and 19. There were crowds before Jesus that were eyewitnesses to Jesus and Jesus' death on the cross. In Luke 23, the Roman soldiers were so sure that Jesus was dead that they didn't even break his legs. They knew that he was dead, and that's in John chapter 19. After his death, Jesus was wrapped in some 100 pounds of cloth and spices and placed in a sealed tomb that was heavily guarded for 3 days. If he hadn't died beforehand, those conditions in themselves would have been fatal. So my question is this, why all of the debate? Why is there doubt that the crucifixion of Christ actually happened? It was a real and factual event. So oftentimes in our culture and in our media, they portray Christians and Christianity as people who just follow faith blindly. Do any of if you're a Christian, do you follow your faith blindly? But I would argue that that is not the case, certainly not in my life. That is not what the church teaches, and that is not what Jesus taught. In the scriptures, Jesus always, he presented evidence and miracles that he is God. And then he followed that up by questions. Do you believe? Will you follow me? This is the way that Jesus did it. This is the way the church does it. And that's the way that, we do it. Do we accept the evidence or do we not? In my own life, this has been the pattern. God has presented himself as real to me in my life. That is the testimony in my life. I have always made decisions to follow God off of belief in God and based off of the evidence that was presented to me and that was given to me by God. But my faith journey has had different seasons, if you want to put it that way. And I believe that all of us are that way. When I was a child, I went to Sunday school. And most of us, a lot of us did that. We went to Sunday school and I would learn about Jesus through the scriptures and through kinesthetic things, you know, making little pictures and crayons and things like that. And that's how I learned about Jesus. When I was in high school, I had to depend on my faith during peer pressure and during times of doubt. And I had to depend on my faith during that time. When I was in college, I experienced God in a whole nother way. I experienced God through worship and through doing missions around the world and just seeing what God is doing in the lives of people around the world. And during that time as well, during college, I began to develop healthy questions about God. It's good to have questions about your faith, about the Bible, and about God. For me, I chose a path to go to seminary. Not all of us can do that. But in seminary, this is my testimony, I studied ancient Greek and ancient Hebrew. I don't know modern Hebrew or modern Greek, but I studied those, and I went through the entire Bible thoroughly in the original languages. This only increased my faith as I saw the accuracy and the truthfulness of the scriptures. After seminary, I began my quest to solidify my faith, if you want to put it that way, through apologetics. Apologetics is just a fancy word that means defending the faith. And I sought out and I read many books to solidify my faith. Can you go to the next slide? This is just my, at our house, I just put 15 books out. And these are just 15, and the office had a lot more. And there are hundreds of books out there that will solidify and answer your questions about faith, that will factually prove that Jesus was on the cross and that he resurrected in the history of the church. And this is 15 of them. I solidified my faith through fact, through research, through evidence. And I found the answer to these difficult questions that I'm sure that a lot of you have had before. Can we prove that we were created by a creator? Why is there evil in the world? That's the number one question I get asked by non-believers. Why, if there is a God, why is there evil in the world? Why would a loving God send people to hell? These are questions that I've answered through this research, and I found sufficient answers to these. Why would God allow natural disasters, hurricanes, tsunamis? Do science and the Bible clash? This is a big one that is a big question for me. Does science line up with the Bible? You know, what does this mean? What about dinosaurs? What are all of these things? Actually, I'm still looking at dinosaurs. But, and is the Bible real? That one is sufficiently answered. And going through all of these books and history and evidences, I solidified my faith through facts. And finally, is Jesus real? And this was my quest. This is how I know God. And you will probably see this through my 10 a.m. Bible teachings, through my sermons, through my testimony, I am 150% sure that God is God and that the Bible is real, and just looking at how it lines up. And I say all this to say that there are answers to our doubts. Doubt is part of the cross, but you have to answer those questions for yourself. I can help you. I can give you the names of these books and the other books, but you have to answer your own doubts for yourselves. And as Christians, and even God seekers, as the Bible, there were Jews who were seeking God, and they called them God seekers in the New Testament. We have to seek out those answers. But in this world, many people still refuse to believe. Can you go to the next slide? There is an estimated 1.6 billion people who follow the religion of Islam today. And Islam believes that Jesus never died on the cross and that he never rose, therefore he never rose from the dead. Their religious book of Islam the fourth surah, and I'm not going to put it up there, but verses 157 to 58, just so you know, I'm not telling a lie, it tells us readers that Jesus never died and was never crucified on the cross. In fact, they come up with a hypothesis that somebody else died on the cross for Jesus. They even give a name, says possibly Judas Iscariot. So they deny that Jesus died on the cross, even though for 600 years the church and the evidence and history have proven that Jesus did die on the cross. But they cast a doubt, a shadow, through another religion, through their religion. And with it, followers numbering in the billions of people throughout the history of Islam have had doubt about the crucifixion of Jesus on the cross. Modern authors as well try to debunk and cast doubt on the crucifixion of Christ. Just one example is Michael Bajens. I don't know how to pronounce that. He recently passed away. He authored many famous books trying to disprove the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. And there are these books out there, and there's movies out there. In fact, I just saw that The Case for Christ by Lee Strobel, which is an excellent book, just came out. A movie just came out. My church in San Francisco just watched that. It's in the theaters now. Maybe we should go watch it, The Case for Christ. But modern authors, they really just have this niche where they try to disprove Christianity. Michael Bajin, one of his most publicized books was The Jesus Papers, exposing the greatest cover-up in history. And in this book, he claims that he saw an ancient document written in Aramaic that disproved that Jesus, it didn't prove that he didn't exist, but he had all of these explanations in there. But the weird thing is he doesn't even read Aramaic. So how did he get this? Anyways, there's a book by Lee Strobel. It's called In Defense of Jesus. It totally tears apart Michael Bajin's theories. And his theory was that Jesus took some concoction before the cross, and that afterwards, through some sort of alloys and things like that, they woke him up. So that was just, and he also argued that Rome would have never killed Jesus because Jesus instructed his disciples to pay taxes to Caesar. So he comes up with all of these ideas, but again, defending the faith through apologetics, Lee Strobel and other Christian apologetists have just completely debunked his theories, and it's included in the fact that the guy doesn't even read Aramaic, so how did he read these ancient papers that happened to not exist? The point being that those that doubt the Bible and Jesus' crucifixion are far and wide. We know that whether it's a different religion or modern society or the news or whatever, it's the doubts about Jesus' crucifixion are far and wide, and even his resurrection is doubted. So how does one overcome this doubt? What would it take for the world's doubt to be satisfied? And I believe the only thing that can satisfy doubt is truth. Can you go to the next slide? I try to come up with this, that if doubt were emptiness of a glass, then truth would be the substance that fills that emptiness. I used the metaphor, rolling off of last week's theme, that only truth can quench doubt. So this is a truth. And in our scriptures today, Jesus presents truth to the world. These two chapters are about truth. And he leaves us with a choice to believe in truth or not to believe. So first, John chapter 18, verses 28. Jesus, and he's brought before Pilate by the Jews, and they're demanding that he be executed, as we just heard. Pilate is well aware of the sensitivity of the situation. There had already been several rebellions at this point in Jerusalem, and if there was another rebellion during the Passover, Pilate would be accountable to Caesar. He would have lost his position. So he had to be sure that there were no rebellions. And it only takes one person to lead a mob. And during this time in these scriptures John 18 and 19, the city has swollen in ranks, and people were coming from all over the world to celebrate Passover. And if somebody, for example, Jesus, were to lead a mob and things were to get out of hand and thousands of people were to die, it would be Pilate's head. So they bring Pilate before, they bring Jesus before Pilate. And in verse, Pilate takes Jesus inside of a palace and he asks him, and he says, "Are you the king of the Jews?" And then Pilate, and then, "Is that your own idea?" Jesus asked. So I'm kind of reading this. This is 33 through 38. "So, are you the king of the Jews?" Pilate asked Jesus. "Is that your own idea?" Jesus asked. "Or did others talk to you about me?" "I am a Jew," Pilate replied. "Am I a Jew?" Pilate replied. "Your own people and your own chief priests have handed you over to me. What is it that you have done?" And so this is part of the interrogation. Jesus said, "My kingdom is not of this world. If it were, my servants would fight to prevent my arrest by the Jewish leaders. But now my kingdom is from another place." "You are a king, then," said Pilate. Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. In fact, the reason I was born and the reason that I came into this world is to testify to the truth. Everyone on the side of truth listens to me." And then Pilate says this, and it's a kind of telling statement. And he says, "What is truth?" Pilate replied. With this, he went out again to the Jews gathered there, and he said, "I find no basis for charges against them," against Jesus. And in this interrogation, Pilate, he strives for the truth. Kingship is the first thing that's at hand. Pilate says, "Are you the king of the Jews?" In verse 33, Pilate asked Jesus, "And are you challenging Rome?" Basically is what he's getting at. "Are you about to lead a rebellion?" And the answer is no. Is Jesus a threat to Rome? Not now, but later. But no, he is not right now. Jesus is not a threat to Rome. Is Jesus the messianic king? Yes, he is. Verse 36, Jesus says, his kingdom is not from this world. Jesus says his kingdom is from another place. Jesus says that if his kingdom were from this world, that his servants would fight to prevent him from being arrested. And that's why in John chapter 18, verse 11, when Jesus was arrested after the famous kiss of Judas Iscariot, Peter pulls out the sword and he actually slices off one of the chief priest's servant's ear. And Jesus says to Peter, "Put away your sword." And then he miraculously heals his ear. And then Jesus does not, he's telling his servants, don't fight with sword for this. And then Jesus, after Jesus commanded Peter to put away his sword, Jesus willingly gives himself up to the authorities. And he follows that by this, and he says, "Shall I not drink from the cup the Father has given me?" Jesus proclaimed, as he gave himself to the Jewish official soldiers, that he is from a king. He is from a kingdom that is not from this world. And for this reason that Jesus was born into this world, in verse 37, and this is the capsule, to testify to the truth. So this whole interrogation, Jesus has been arrested, and he's brought before the Sanhedrin, he's found guilty, and then he's brought before Pilate. And it all leads to this one statement that Jesus says, "I am here to testify to the truth." The kingdom of God was clashing with the kingdom of the world, with Rome. The kingdom of God was clashing with Rome and with Israel, and the two worlds, they were coming face to face in John 18 and 19. And one kingdom had weapons of metal to fight. And the other kingdom had the weapon of truth. And these were the two kingdoms. And Jesus is that truth. And Jesus is the reality of God. And he was coming into that kingdom. And Jesus came to reveal to the world that he is the truth. And that anyone on his side listens to him. And that's in verse 37. So the question comes to, there is doubt, and then doubt is fulfilled through truth. So the question is, what is truth? According to the Bible, truth is when God's kingdom overcomes the kingdom of this world. That is what truth is. This is in a nutshell. I mean, we could go on and on, what is truth? But in a nutshell, God, the truth is when God's kingdom overcomes this kingdom, it has to do with opening your eyes and your ears and your heart to who is God and what is his message and what is truth and literally who is truth. So let me paint a picture of what that will look like. When the kingdom of God overcomes the kingdom of this world, it will look like this. God will be with his people, and God's people will be with God. It'll kind of look, honestly, like the Garden of Eden. Genesis, this portrays itself all throughout the New Testament, even into Revelation. Genesis is, we have to keep that in mind. The kingdom, God will be with his people, and God's people will be with God, and God will be amongst us. That's what Emmanuel means, God with us. There will be a renewal of all things. There will be a judgment on God's enemies. There will be healing of all diseases, including death. There will be forgiving of all sins. And then there will be a covenant, a new covenant between God and man. And then this, according to the book of Isaiah, will be accomplished through a Messiah, through a chosen one, who will bring the kingdom of God into the kingdom of men. This sums up the Old and New Testament. And as Jesus stands before Pilate, this is his testimony during this interrogation. I am king, and my kingdom is not of this world, and I have come into this world to testify the truth, and I am the truth. And all who side with me, and all who side with truth, listen to me. And at that, verse 38, Pilate asked, well, what is truth? And then he walks away. And this is one of the saddest verses in the Bible. Jesus tells Pilate, what is truth? And deep down, we're all looking for truth. Truth, I believe, is the only thing that can answer doubt. And Jesus tells Pilate, what is truth? And Pilate says, what is truth? And then he walks away. Because he doesn't think that there's a real answer. How can you overcome doubt if you don't believe that there is truth? And this is kind of getting philosophical, and it is getting very deep, but that is part of the opening of your eyes and the revealing of the scriptures. There's this paradox that the world lingers in. Truth today has become relative. And I don't want to get like too deep into this, but literally truth has become relative. What's true for you is not true for me. Therefore, your truth can't answer my doubts. If you think about that. And it's a snare of lies. If nobody knows what truth is, then it's a lie. And the world has become so confused that it doesn't even know what questions to ask anymore. That was confusing in itself. It comes down to this. How can you overcome doubt if you don't even know where to find truth? If you have doubts about the cross and about is Jesus who he says he is, then how are you going to overcome those doubts if you don't even know where to find the truth? And that's what this is all about. But there's a beauty in this, and it's here in these chapters, and it's called the cross. And this is the way that I describe the cross. If you remember Thanksgiving, I described the cross as God's invitation. The greatest party ever in the history of mankind needs to have an invitation. That's the greatest invitation that man in the history of mankind, and that's the cross. But in this scripture, I want to point it this way: the cross is literally a giant X that God has painted for all of mankind to see, for everyone who wants to find the truth. The cross is a giant X painted in the history of it. Remember, it's the most documented event in all of history. And God painted it literally so that we can find truth. Because truth has become relative. We don't even know what questions to ask. But this is God's treasure map to us. Follow the map to the X. When I was a little kid in Mississippi, should we say it? Mississippi. I used to bury, I had so many silver dollars, and I had these wooden boxes. I was into pirates and swords and all those things. And then I used to bury all of my coins all over the yard and write on a piece of paper, and they all got lost. And one day I want to go back and find those points just for the heck of it, because to say, I remember this. But that's the way this is. This is a giant X that even a child can find who wants to find the truth. And Jesus says that he is the truth, and he is the way, and he is the life. That he has come into the world to testify to the truth, and that everyone on the side of truth listens to him. And in these two chapters, Jesus willingly journeys to the cross to paint a giant X for the world to find this truth. Can you go to the next slide? John 18:38. Pilate, he brings, Jesus has been in captivity, and Pilate, he brings two captives before the crowd. And this gets really interesting when this happens. Pilate, he brings these two captives. On the one hand is Barabbas, if you know this story, and on the other hand is Jesus. And Barabbas, by all accounts, and even mentioned in the book of John, that Barabbas is a terrorist. He's a zealot. He's a rebellion. John calls him a bandit that took part in a rebellion against Rome. So this is, on one hand, Barabbas. And literally his name, Bar-Abbas, means son of God. Son of the Father. Isn't that ironic? Pilate is saying, you choose. Here is Barabbas, who his name means son of the Father. And on the other hand is Jesus, who was also the son of the Father. Although in a very different manner. And the crowd was given this choice. Who do you set free? Do you choose Barabbas, who has a record of violence and terrorism? Or do you choose to set free Jesus, who is innocent and who will not fight? Jesus willingly gave himself up, and Jesus even told his followers to put down your swords. Do you choose Jesus, or do you choose the one who would fight oppression, who would fight the world with the sword and with fight? Or do you choose the one who would fight the world with truth? And it is, I don't know how God set this up, but it's, do you choose a sword, or do you choose truth? And then Pilate gave the crowd this decision, and they chose the sword, as mankind has always done. They chose the wrong son of the wrong father. And in chapter 19, can you go to the next slide? Pilate, he has Jesus flogged. And historians tell us that many during that time did not even survive this flogging. Flogging, if you don't know, I'm not going to go too much into the details, but it was a sadistic way of torture. It was a whip that was fastened at the end with pieces of bone and shrapnel. And it would definitely tear your flesh. And almost always, it would reveal your flesh, it would reveal bone. Blood. And if you ever watched The Passion of Christ by Mel Gibson, I think that that's probably about as close as we can come to visually looking at that. But this is, Pilate had Jesus flogged, and the severity of those floggings would have left open wounds and bones exposed. And the prophet Isaiah, the one who wrote about this Messiah that was going to bring the kingdom of God into the kingdom of the world, he wrote about this Messiah in Isaiah 53. And he said this, and he said that the Messiah's journey to free the world would be painful and full of suffering. And he said this about this Messiah, and he said, surely he took up our pain, and he bore our sufferings. Yet we considered him punished by God, and stricken by him, and afflicted. But this Messiah, the one bringing the kingdom of God, he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. And the punishment that brought us peace was on him. And by his wounds, we are healed. And after these floggings, Jesus, Pilate brings him before the crowd, and Jesus stands before the crowd. And by this time, he has a crown of thorns, which are bloody. So he's standing before the crowd. He has a thorns, a crown on his head. He has a purple robe, which has to be drenched in blood. And his body and his face, they're bruised and they're broken and they're bloody. And the crowd shouts, and they choose, and they say, "Crucify, crucify." And that's what John 19:6. And when Pilate demands a basis, and this is where it gets really, really interesting. Pilate, he demands, "Why do you want this man to be crucified?" Can you go to the next slide? And the people, they answered, they said, "We have a law, and according," let me fix this. Sorry. They said that we have a law, and according to the law, he must die because he claimed to be the Son of God. Sorry, give me one second. I might have to speak really loud. Can you hear me? Let me do this. I would love to do this. Let's go. Try this. Let's do it old school. So, all right, they got Pilate, and he says, why do you want to crucify him? Why do you want to have him arrested? And then they said this, and they said, "We have a law, and according to that law, he must die. Because, why? Because he claimed to be the Son of God." And then it says this telling thing, the scriptures in verse 8, they tell us that when Pilate heard this, he was even more afraid. Why was Pilate afraid? He had been given all the power of Rome, and he was afraid. And so Pilate, what does he do? He takes Jesus back into his palace, and he says, "Jesus, who are you?" And the reason he's saying this, because Pilate, he had Greek and Roman background. And he would have believed that God's plural would have come to mankind, sometimes a type of demigods like Hercules, if you want to put it in. They sometimes came and visited mankind. And then here is Jesus, and he's saying that he is the Son of God. And Pilate was afraid. "Are you a divine man? Are you from above?" And then the conversation, it turns to power. And then Pilate, he claims to have the authority of Rome and the power of death and life over Jesus. And he says, "Don't you know that I can have you killed or crucified?" And Jesus, he responds with this in verse 11. It says, "You have no power if it were not given to you by God." And this is the kicker of the whole thing. Jesus reveals in this one sentence that this whole thing has been orchestrated by God. Jesus, that God is in control and has always been in control. And that Pilate, he's afraid and he tries to set Jesus free. But he realizes that he has no power over the crowds. He goes back to the crowds, and they demand that he be crucified. And so the whole thing, Rome is powerless, and Pilate gives in to the breakdown of humanity, if you really think about it that way. Humanity is saying, "Crucify Jesus." And in verse 16, Pilate hands Jesus over to be crucified. And in the end, everyone is powerless to this sin. And can you go to the next slide? And this brings us to the end of the story. Can the worship team prepare to lead us in worship? So it brings us to the end of the story, which is the cross. That's why we're here. That's our hope is in the cross. And it brings us to that. In John chapter 12, right before Jesus began to journey to the cross, he told the crowds this. In 12:31, he said, "Now is the time for judgment on this world. Now the prince of this world will be driven out, and I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself." And he said this to show what kind of death he was going to die. So this is Jesus' prophecy, that I will now be lifted up and I will draw all people to myself. Those people who are seeking for the truth. And a time is coming and is now here when the Son of God will be lifted up on the cross. That giant X marks the spot for all those who have doubt, for all those who are seeking truth about who is our God. Why are we here? What is my purpose here on earth? And the King of the world was coronated on the cross. And the powers of darkness were to be overthrown. God would draw all people who who seek after him to himself. And the funny thing is, no one even saw it coming. But through the testimony of the cross, it has been revealed through this giant X, not only truth, but that God loves us, and that God died for us, and that Jesus on the cross is the way and the truth and the life, and that everyone on the side of truth will listen to Jesus. And then he goes on to say these amazing words, that the truth will set you free. And it's amazing things happen on that cross. We can't even go into it all, but somehow or another, through the grace and the mercy of God, he turns our sins into his righteousness. He turns all of our sins, all of our disobedience, all of our running away from God into his righteousness. And in return, he made us righteous for all of those who call on the name of Jesus, and all of those who believe in him receive life. And the question comes back to the last point, believe. Belief. Do you believe this? Do you believe in the fact that the cross has been proven through for thousands of years, the fact of the cross? Do you believe this? Second, are your doubts satisfied through the truth? Are your doubts satisfied through Jesus? And then finally, do you believe that Jesus died on the cross for you, that you might become the righteousness of God? And this is where we'll close it, that if all of your hope and faith are fulfilled through Jesus on the cross, then rejoice, because you are counted amongst the sons and daughters of God. But yet, if you have yet to approach Jesus Christ through faith, if you have yet to believe in him, then the invitation is there. The giant X is there. It says, I am the way, I am the truth, I am your life. For God loved the world so much that he gave his only begotten Son. I have come that you can have life, and life to the fullest. While we were yet still in our sins, God demonstrated his love for us in that he sent his only Son to die. And the follow-up to that is, if you believe, you will receive the Son of God as your Lord, as your Savior. John chapter 3 describes this, the spiritual process where we become sons and daughters of God, not born of flesh, but born of the Spirit. Not anything that we can do, but what God will do through us. And this is all through belief in Jesus Christ. So this is your invitation. If you guys will close your eyes, just out of respect for one another, out of respect for God. And I'm going to ask this question. Is there anyone in here who has not confessed to Jesus that you believe in him, and that you need him, and that you receive all of his promises, his forgiveness of sins, his love, his life, his truth, his way to the Father? Is there anyone in here who wants to become a son or daughter of God? If that's you, will you raise your hand? The cross is an invitation from God for salvation, for righteousness, eternal life. Simplified, the cross is the love of God for us. Just raise your hand if you want to confess to Jesus Christ. You need him and you believe in him. close us in a time of prayer. And the worship team is going to lead us in worship of Jesus Christ. Continue to bow with me as we just pray. Father God, Jesus, you are magnificent. You've orchestrated throughout history, Jesus Christ, your great invitation, Jesus. You knew our faults and our shortcomings and our rebellious attitudes towards you, our Creator. You knew that we could never have perfect love without you. You knew that we could never be righteous without you. You knew that we couldn't even love one another without you, Jesus Christ. And you orchestrated this whole event. The most documented event in the history of mankind. It's right there before us, Jesus. And you were raised up on the cross that you might draw all men to yourself, all men and women to yourself, that we might become sons and daughters of God, that we might receive your life, that we can experience your grace and your mercy and your kindness, and that we can have a relationship with you, God. Your kingdom come here on earth as it is in heaven. Your prayer that you taught us to pray, Jesus Christ. Jesus, all of our hope and all of our faith are seen through the lens of the cross. And we thank you. We pray this in your name.